Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So last month, before Christmas break, I had to drive my youngest son, Jonathan, into Houston from out where we live to Hobby Airport. It was 5 o'clock p.m. on a Friday night. Christmas vacation break had just started. It was dark. It was rainy. And I usually use a navigation app, Waze. Perhaps some of you use that one as well. Yep. I like Waze because it alerts me to where the police are, right? Usually at that time of day and day of the week, when I make that airport run, Waze has me come in on 290, get off on I-10, and then exit Washington Avenue, weave me through Rice Military, and then it puts our lives in jeopardy a bit because it wants us to turn left onto Memorial off some side street during rush hour. It's impossible. So I gripped the wheel that night coming into town hoping that Waze had other ideas for us. And let me tell you, Waze did not disappoint. Again, coming into Houston on 290, headed to Hobby. Y'all know where that is, off 45. But Waze told me to get off on Pinemont. That's before Restaurant Row coming in, right? And head east, that way. The roads went from four lanes down to one-lane side streets filled with garbage cans. And in the darkness, I see Jonathan turn and look at me as I'm driving. And I just kept driving and said, yeah, I know. On Tuesday night, Waze had me driving through the garbage can alleys of River Oaks. We're good. And we ended up getting spit out on I-45 somewhere, and we're able to make it in. But just so you all know, it has been a journey for me of tens of thousands of miles, tens of thousands of miles, back and forth to Houston to serve as an interim at two different churches here in town, for me to finally quit arguing, mostly, right, with the navigation apps that I use, giving over my control and learning to trust and follow the directions of that omnipresent voice in the car, right? By the way, you should know I have already, Siri's on probation, just saying. Siri has ticked me off and it's on probation. And so anyway, I know that I am quite certain that all of us have our own tales about where our navigation apps have sent us. And that we've all struggled with those same issues. So it is so hard to give up control and listen and trust that something or someone, what someone else is telling us, right? Be it a navigation app or the person in the passenger seat, it's hard. And I like to think that that kind of stubbornness that we all have is a gift. The trick is to harness that gift and use it for good, not evil, right? To use it to pull ourselves and others up, not to make our life and their lives miserable. So I want us to think about this stubbornness this morning as a gift, right? And I want us to think of that gift and take it just a little bit because we want to use our gifts for good, right? So I want to reframe that gift of stubbornness. And listen for this word change. I want us to think about it instead of stubbornness over here, but as persistence, right? Because we do both, right? Sometimes at the same time. So give some thought to when we're both stubborn and persistent, to the when and the where in life, where we were stubborn or headstrong or were persistent and had to persevere in any way. I'm going to ask this question. Were we alone in those moments? And I'll ask the God question, and where was God in the midst of it all? So for those of us familiar with that old poem, Footprints, we have this idea of how our relationship with God works in the midst of those difficult times of life. I will share with you, my difficult moments and my relationship with God look more like a cartoon drawn by Chris Straub. There are two figures pictured in the cartoon. One is God, and then God has God's arm around another person figure. And in frame number one, God says, my child, I never left you. That place with two sets of prints, that's where I carried you. This is me. In frame two, God says, but you see that long groove over there? That's where I dragged you for a while. Right? Stubbornness and persistence. Even in relationship with God, even knowing that God is with us in the midst of it all, our stubbornness and persistence moves us forward and holds us back until our relationship with God sort of mirrors our relationship with our navigation apps. Listen to the voice, struggle with the voice. Listen to the voice, follow the directions. What we need, right, is an epiphany to remind us of who we are and whose we are, that we might trust that voice, that that voice is indeed the way and will lead us in the way that we have chosen as disciples of Jesus. Well, as luck would have it, this is the season of Epiphany, and so every Sunday we are giving thanks for the waters of our baptism and remembering who we are and whose we are. And this morning, we have a voice in the wilderness reminding us of who Jesus is. Our voice in the wilderness this morning comes to us from the Gospel of John. It is John the Baptist. Last week, we heard about the baptism of Jesus in Matthew's Gospel, but in this week's reading, we only hear the testimony of John the Baptist about that event. His private proclamation to us as leaders of the Gospel of John is what we hear this morning. I'm going to read that passage of Scripture again for us, but I'm going to read it from the Message. You're welcome to follow along in your bulletins. That translation is the New Revised Standard Version. But this is the Message, a little more street language in here. Beginning at verse 29. The very next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and yelled out, here he is, the Lamb of God, God's Passover Lamb. He forgives the sins of the world. This is the man I've been talking about, the one who comes after me but is really ahead of me. I knew nothing about who he was, only this, that my task has been to get Israel ready to recognize him as the God revealer. That is why I came baptizing with water, giving you a good bath and scrubbing sins from your life so that you can get a fresh start with God. John clinched his witness with this. I watched the Spirit like a dove flying down out of the sky, making himself at home in him. I repeat, I know nothing about him except this. The one who authorized me to baptize with water told me, the one on whom you see the Spirit come down and stay, this one will baptize with the Holy Spirit. That's exactly what I saw happen. And I'm telling you, there's no question about it. This is the Son of God. So says the voice in the wilderness. The question is, do we embrace the truth that is offered to us in his testimony? Or do we struggle with it? Or do we choose differently? The Gospel of John does not give us time to think because he moves us forward to another testimony of John the Baptist. This time, John the Baptist is standing with two of his disciples, and as Jesus walks by, he exclaims, look, here is the Lamb of God. And these two disciples were followers of John the Baptist. They had been listening to John speak about the one who comes after me, but is really ahead of me, the one who is the God revealer, the Son of God. And when they saw John point to Jesus and say to him, look, here is the Lamb of God, these two disciples began following Jesus. And then Jesus speaks. For the first time in John's Gospel, Jesus speaks and he says to them, what are you looking for? And the disciples struggle to answer that question. They only manage to get out, teacher, and where are you staying? And so Jesus invites them to come and see. And lives for centuries later have been changed. Now, I wonder about those of us who find ourselves in the wilderness of life, wondering about so much. What is it that helps us persevere in those tough times? Is it our faith in God? Or is it because we are networked into a faith community like this one to welcome and to support us, to comfort and pray for us, to share in fellowship and holy communion during those tough times? I hope so. But what about those among us, or those watching online, or those friends that we have in our lives that we just don't give up on, who struggle with feeling and finding the presence of God in the wilderness of their lives? How do we help them persevere? How do we point them to the Lamb of God, the God Revealer? Might we offer them the same thing that we do for each other? A place to feel welcome, to call home here at Faith. Offering them words of comfort, support, prayer, most of all, fellowship. Might our communion with them, as we break ourselves open and share our faith stories and witness to the presence of God in our lives, might that kind of communion be holy as well? It is from out there in the wilderness that we came here this morning, seeking some kind of direction in our lives. Perhaps some of us are here listening for an omnipresent voice to speak to us, offering us the answers and directions we seek. Perhaps some of us are here this morning wondering if a voice didn't lead us here today. And I wonder, as disciples who seek the God-revealing Christ in our lives, have we figured out what it is that we are looking for? Might the opportunities to discover the answers actually be right in front of us or next to us? Perhaps we should stop resisting the voice of God calling to us from deep within. Instead, learn how to listen deeply for that invitation from Jesus to come and see what is right in front of us. Amen.